Good day to everyone. Thank you for having invited me to this conference, this international conference. And I would like to thank Farzana Gounder and also Ganesh Chand for having accepted my paper and the members of the committee. My theme is on returning immigrants, on circular migration, and the savings that they took back to India. That's why the title, Deporting Mauritian Shores. So basically, I'll get down to it, and I'll start with the story of one of my ancestors. His name is Immigrant Mohan, a Bengali who came from the 24th Parganas near Calcutta. He was the great-grandfather of my great-grandmother. In 1838, he came as an indentured worker at the age of 30, went back to India in 1842. In 1846, returned to Mauritius as a labor recruiter, Sirdar. And by 1851, he had already established himself on a sugar estate in the north of the island. And he invited his two daughters, one of my ancestors, one of his daughters, it was one of my ancestors, his son-in-law and two grandsons to come and live in Mauritius. In 1851, in the same year, he made a first land purchase. And then he became a very successful, what Richard Allen called an entrepreneur Indian immigrant. He bought land, sold land, he made profits, and really he started land ownership in our family. In 1869, he was photographed at the immigration depot of the Upper Vasigat World Heritage Site. And in 1871, barely 2 years later, he wrote a letter of farewell to his family and returned to India. He returned to the 24 Parganas where he got settled. And for 6 years, he was a benefactor to his fellow countrymen, to the villagers, and to his family who remained there. He took back with him almost 3,000 rupees or £300 sterling, which he invested and created a small estate there. And in 1877, at the age of 70 plus, he passed away. And I told you this story because this is my entry point for this paper, where we're talking about returning immigrants who took back money back to India. And in the historiography, this is one of the lacunae. When we look at historiography in the last 30 to 40 years, very little has been covered on the returning immigrants, the remittances that they sent back, and also returning immigrants who were engaged in circular migration between India, Mauritius, and other parts of the former colonial plantation world. So when we look at the historiography in Mauritius, it's Marina Carter in the 90s and early 2000s who started this pioneering work. You also had Lila Gajeda Sarup, who also wrote about returning immigrants and remittances, money sent back to the immigrants. And in Reunion Island, you have Govindin Sully, who has looked at it. You have also Ashutosh Kumar, who looked at it from the perspective of India and immigrants going to Mauritius, Fiji, and Guyana and Fiji, Trinidad and returning. In South Africa, you have scholars such as Surendra Banna and also understood Ghulam Vahid also has had a look at this issue. In Fiji, of course have Brij Lal who covered it as per the works that he did over the years ever since the 1980s. And also you have Chan Choini and Professor Moritz Hassan Khan in Suriname. And this is still one of the fields that still needs to be explored. In Guyana, you have Romash Rupnarayan, who's looked at it, and also of Indo-Guyanese who returned to India. So this is one of the things that I'm also looking at, Indo-Mauritians who returned to India, Mother India, with their relatives. So the period that I'm looking at specifically is 1860 to 1930, covers a 70-year period. And basically, there is a series in the MGI, the Mahatma Gandhi Institute Archives, which has been recorded, registered on the UNESCO Memory of the World Register back in 2015. There's a very unique set of documents in the PJ series of returning immigrants, consisting of 58 volumes covering the same period, 1860 to 1930, where documents are returned, the biodata and full details about more than 108,000 immigrants. Ever since 2017, the articles of Lomash have served as a source of inspiration, and the work of Marina Carter, with whom I've written a book. My first book was published with her, where we looked at returning immigrants. So basically, we have among the 108,000 immigrants, around 80,000, they or three quarters paid their own passages, and also they took with them their savings, their remittances, gold, silver, and money, valued at almost, from my preliminary estimate, almost 14 million rupees over a period of 70 years among these 80,000 immigrants. And some of them were Indo-Mauritians, they paid around 2.5 million for their return passages. As you can see, it is a large amount of money. Why do we take this approach? Basically, to finally debunk the parenting caring paradigm, and also to subscribe to what Northrop said, that indentured immigration was not far off from the free immigration of the long century of the 19th century and early 20th centuries, that we have to change our view of indentured labor. At the same time, when we look at this, it is millions of rupees which are taken out of the colony, and you have colonial officials such as successive governors, Governor Barclay, Governor Gordon, Governor Pope Hennessy, and successive protector of immigrants from Mauritius, who have complained that a lot of money was being taken out of the colony when these indentured immigrants left Mauritius. We must bear in mind that 3/4 of all of these returning immigrants paid their own passages and also took savings with them, all right? And among them, there were 15,000 Indo-Mauritians, Mauritians who were born here, who returned to Mother India with their mothers, fathers, brothers, sisters, and others, which is a very important point. In the last 15 years that I've helped Indian Indo-Mauritians, Muslims, Christians, and Hindus to retrace their families out of 200, I noticed around 20 of them, their ancestors returned to India, including my own, just like immigrant Mohan. And one of the things that we have to bear in mind is how much did it cost? It cost around 34 rupees back in the 1860s, 1870s to return to India. In the 1860s, around 23 rupees. And by the early 1900s, it was 40 rupees. We must remember, this is equivalent to almost 6 months of the wages of a simple worker. And in Mauritius, its peculiarity is that most women who came did not come to work under an indenture. If you are familiar with the work of Marina Carter, Lakshmi's Legacy, and some of the recent works from my own, 2017, they came to Mauritian shores, we documented this fully. And most of them, on average, out of these 80,000 immigrants, around, they took with them back savings amounting to anywhere from 143 to 183 rupees. When combined with the return passages, it amounted to almost 200, 213 rupees, which represented almost 3.5 years worth of salary. And most of them who returned were immigrants who had remained in the colony, served 2-3 contracts, labor contracts, even 4 contracts. So they were in the colony for anywhere from 10 to 15 to 20 to 25 years. And we have documented cases like Mohan, of hundreds, even thousands of immigrants through the PJ series who remained in the Mauritius for 10, 15, 30, 40, even 40, even 50 years, and then returning to India. The question that is asked is why? Well, one of the answers is that one of my ancestors went back, the brother of my great-grandmother, who was an Arya Samaj priest, went to visit his relatives in the 1950s in the 24 Parganas. That is where we got information on Mohan as a returning immigrant. That he went back, he died in 1877. And the reason he went back, he wanted to return to the land of his ancestors, to his native village, live out the rest of his life there with his family, with his people, with his villagers, and die peacefully in his native village, which might be an indicator of why so many immigrants, having worked so many years, they return to Mother India. Well, one of the things is when we talk about savings, for example, in 1876, there were around 700 immigrants who had something around 90,000 rupees in the government savings banks. In 1876, the Protector of Immigrants writes, and he says that around 1/3 of the immigrants took out something around 25 to 30,000 rupees. The main reason why, because they were returning to India, to Calcutta, Madras, or to Bombay. So this gives an indication of the amount of money that the immigrants took back. So the indentured labor system was not only an exploitative system, but also some immigrants, given the situation of famines, wars, and problems in India, there was also, apart from the push factor, a pull factor as well. They could earn savings in Mauritius, they could make a better life for themselves, and some even purchase property and in what is known as the Grand Mosalma movement. I can tell you that there are more than 25,000 Indian immigrants or Indo-Mauritians who bought more than 90,000 acres of land from 1850 to 1950, and they spent more than 50 million rupees. So this is an indicator again of the socioeconomic mobility and the economic opportunities in Mauritius. So basically, there are other case studies that I've looked at apart from these 80,000 immigrants or 108,000 immigrants. In the PJ series, there are 4 volumes, PJ 36 through PJ 42, which has a lot of information on these immigrants. And this accounts to almost 1/3 or 40% of all those who returned from 1860 to 1930. And in that batch, there are around 7.5 million rupees that were spent in savings and in terms of returning immigrants paying their passages. And I can tell you, one of the things that I found in my research is that around 28,000 returned to India. They were paid by the government. Part of this government money came from the money that was paid, the return passages that was paid by some of these immigrants. So as you can see, the system didn't depend entirely on the colonial treasury, but also on the savings and the money coming from the Indian immigrants, the returning immigrants or the returnees. I'll give you a very simple example. For example, a ship called the Sindia, there were around 138 immigrants who took with them 1,938 pounds sterling, which amounts to 19,300 rupees. This is in 1860. And there are some immigrants, for example, the Siodals and labor contractors took with them more than 1,600 rupees. You must remember that Mohan took with him 3,000 rupees or 300 pounds sterling. He was a Siodal landowner, etc. You have the Jasmina, which in 1871, sorry, the Sophia Joachim, there are 404 immigrants who took with them 58,000 rupees or 5,800 pounds sterling. And in October 1881, the Condor, there were at least 271 immigrants out of 301, which accounts to 90%, who, when tallying the amount of savings and the remittances that they took with them and the passage that they paid, it amounts to 64,000 rupees. And this is one of 303 ships that I've been documenting over the last 3 years. So it gives you an idea of the amount of money that these immigrants took with them back to India. Okay, so there are other families which I've also documented, apart from my own case studies with their approval, the family of Ram Rachaya, the director of Museums Council here in Mauritius. His ancestor went back and went to his native village and came back with his family a year later. He took more than 1,000 rupees worth of savings. You have the Prayag family, a friend of mine from Cape Town when I was studying there. His ancestor went back with 500 rupees and after almost a year came back with his relatives as well, the entire family, children, etc. Also, his siblings. You have the Lala family, a well-known planter family in Mauritius, where his ancestor went back with 4,000 rupees or 400 pounds sterling worth of savings to help his family. He was also a Bengali, close to the Calcutta area. You also have the Jafar Soba. His ancestor was a Muslim woman who came as a child in 1843. And after having married and made two children, left his family to return back to India to rejoin her family in 1873. So as you can see, you also have other people like Kaushali, who was a Muslim Bengali priest who converted to Anglicanism. He became a Christian. He went back he took almost 1,000 rupees to give to his family in Calcutta. And you also have Parbotia, who was an entrepreneur lady immigrant who did more than 5 trips, again addressing the fact of circular migration. When we look at it, apart from the 15,000 Indo-Mauritians who went back to India, we estimate there are another 15,000 Indians who, and also some free passengers, who also went back to India, came back and went back and did 2 or 3 trips. And this is based on the MGI archives database that we have at our hands. So you can see that it was a very healthy migration going on between Mauritius and India. And this is one of the things that I've been writing about. If you need to estimate how much the 17.5 million rupees that is spent, well, it will go in the hundreds of millions and even go beyond the 1 billion rupee mark, which clearly shows that the immigrants, when they came, they exploited their economic opportunities. There was human agency. They took their destiny into their own hands. Of course, they operated within a very difficult, racist, hierarchical, chauvinistic system. And we have to take it into account. There was exploitation. There was problems, issues of racism, exploitations, and also the labor laws that were passed to control their labor. But at the end of the day, what my research and why I wrote about this and I'm writing about it is that people like Mohan, whom in our family we call Pyare Mohan because of the great benefactor, the money that he started, that he injected into his family and purchasing of land, eventually trickled down that a century later, we can follow the money trail. So these returning immigrants, which we can see by the thousands, they contributed to the development of Mauritius, which I understand in other colonies like Fiji, like Reunion Island, like South Africa, Guyana, Trinidad and Suriname, also there was this phenomenon. And this is one of the why I want to do a broader study in the near future once I complete my study of comparative analysis looking at it from a global perspective, because I can see that this would be a most rewarding experience in terms of looking at how immigrants not only moved from Mauritius to India, but also within the colonies and how much money they took with him, remittances, etc. I will finish with the story of immigrant Tilak Dari, who came in 1843, became a Siodar, an old immigrant entrepreneur. And in 1883, 40 years after having come to Mauritius, he went back to visit his relatives. In 1884, there was a natural disaster in his village, a small village in Ara in West Bihar, where in one day he sent 17 remittances worth 1,000 rupees each, worth a total of 17,000. He sent this to help his families, to help his relatives, to help his people. And this was noted by Protector Trotter in 1884 in a letter that he sent to Governor Sir John Pope Hennessy, which he said never in the history of the Immigration Office that in one day, one immigrant sent 17,000 rupees back to his own relatives. And I would just finish on that note, just to give you an idea of these case studies. So it is both quantitative analysis and qualitative analysis of life stories of these immigrants, also taking it from the global and regional perspectives in what can be done when we look at returning immigrants, when we look at the remittances that we sent, when we look at circular migration, and when we see when the departed Mauritius shores, what they achieve. And of course, there's still a lot of research still to be done. Thank you very much for your attention, and I wish you to have a pleasant conference.